Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome again to Miele Live. We're about 5 minutes away from another episode of Hashtag Miele Dines Local. Today, we're really excited to have Good Sun Restaurant and Chef Vittorio Colacitti here with us. So be sure to tune back in about 5 minutes. Be sure to register on your YouTube page to ask questions in real time with us. So we'll see you in about 5 minutes. Good afternoon. Welcome, bienvenue, willkommen. My name is Kelly Lam. I'm the Vice President of Marketing here at Miele. From our home to yours, we want to welcome you to Miele Live again. It's been a very exciting time for us and a challenging time for many of you as well at home. And Miele Live has been able to bring you answers in real time to questions you have about products that you have in your home, as well as products that you're interested in purchasing. Over the last 9 weeks, many of you have continued to join us live, and we want to thank you for that. I also want to take this opportunity to welcome viewers from across the country. Especially, we have some viewers that have been invited by some of our key retailers partners across the country. From Vancouver, we have customers who have been invited by our retail partners at Trail Appliances, Baker Appliances, Avenue Appliances, Jerome Appliances, Midland Appliances. Here in Ontario, we have Tasco Appliances, Goman Appliances, as well as Appliance Canada. And in the East Coast, we have Creative Appliances in Ottawa, as well as Elmar Appliances in Montreal. So I want to welcome those viewers who have joined us. With Miele Live and with your support, we've now developed a new campaign called Hashtag Miele Dines Local. And we wanted to be able to use the platform of Miele Live to help support some of the local small businesses across the country that have been facing challenging times as well. We've challenged chefs and restaurateurs from across the country to share with us their or one of their signature dishes. And we've invited them to come on to cook with us, whether they're here locally or actually some of the chefs and restaurants, as you have seen, have cooked with us virtually over the last several weeks. And what we're doing as well is we are purchasing 100 meals from the restaurant and the chef, and together with the restaurant, we're actually donating that to frontline workers across the country. Today, we're extremely excited to have Goodsen Restaurant here in Toronto, and they have multiple locations, but we also have Chef Vittorio Colacitti here joining us. Welcome, Chef.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. Yeah. So excited.
Yeah, my pleasure. Yeah.
Many of you may recognize Chef from his appearance on Top Chef, and we'll talk about that later on.
For sure.
But maybe you want to talk to us a bit about Goodsen Restaurant, like when it started, and the philosophy behind the restaurant.
Definitely. Thank you. So the Goodsen, our first location is on Queen Street West, so 1096 Queen West, downtown Toronto. Mm-hmm. It started in 2014. And it was kind of a culmination of all my experiences as a chef to kind of create a menu that was very approachable, but also delicious and, you know, seasonally inspired, and trying to kind of hit on all the things that I've become passionate about throughout my career. And we wanted to do it in a very warm, inviting space and again, make people feel at home. So that's kind of the conceptual side of the Goodsen. And then, you know, since we've opened, it's been an amazing journey. We've had incredible support from locals and from people traveling, and just the community in Toronto. The culinary scene has really taken huge strides forward in the last 20, 30 years, and to be a part of that is really, really cool. So.
And now you have a second location as well.
We do, yeah. So our first location is Queen West. Our second one is at Shops at Don Mills. So 11 Carl Fraser Road is the location there.
Here in Toronto.
Yeah.
And maybe talk a little bit about the menu, actually, on we'll come to kind of what state the restaurant's in right now, what you guys are doing, but before all of the closures happened, what is the inspiration on the menu? What are some of the dishes that are on the menu normally?
Yeah, so basically the way it started was wood fire inspired cuisine. So that was really the main kind of focal point when coming up with menu items. So we have a beautiful wood fire oven in each location, and then we also have a wood fire grill in each location. So we try to use natural cooking techniques, but with elevated, levels of kind of preparation and simple ingredients, but done really well. So I guess that's a bit of a mouthful, but ultimately we kind of coined it as Toronto cuisine because Toronto is such a beautiful multicultural melting pot of all these different food cultures. And I've been very blessed in my career to work with many different types of cuisines through different chefs, and we kind of want to bring that all together. So, and also make it really approachable in the sense we have raw ingredients, and you know, we have oysters, steak tartare, and then we have wood grilled steaks and burgers, and obviously our wood fire pizza. So,
and what's the current status of the restaurant for you? Because obviously we have viewers from across country. In Vancouver, I think they're a couple weeks ahead of us as far as reopening and so forth goes. What's your current situation with Goodsen right now here in Toronto?
So currently we're offering a curbside pickup as well as delivery options. So our wood fire pizza is available. Also our burger kits, which we're going to be making today, are available as well. And we're just kind of trying to figure out how to create the best dishes for the time. And we'll slowly evolve as things gradually reopen, obviously safely.
Yeah.
But for now, we really want to focus on bringing that delicious home, like food that we make in the restaurant home.
Right, and that's keep really, that quality by the time it gets home.
Yeah, that's the goal for sure. And you know, for people to be able to cook at home a little bit too, like we've been trying to kind of encourage that. And obviously, it's been a challenging time for all restaurants and all businesses across the country and across the world. So I think just trying to do our part to kind of make it a little easier.
So right now, your hours of operation, when can people order? How do they order with you guys?
Yeah, so Wednesday through Saturday, 2 p.m. to 9 p.m. through Sunday, 2 p.m. to 9 p.m. You can order through our website or through Uber Eats, Skip the Dishes.
Okay.
But and DoorDash.
And they can go right on your website as well to get all that information.
Yeah, there's an order online link on the website.
Cool.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get you in the comfort of your space, which is cooking.
Cool.
Where do you want to start?
I think we'll do the steak tartare first.
Absolutely.
So steak tartare is one of my favorite things to eat and make. This version I learned from a master chef of France. His name is Didier Lois. So he used to have a beautiful restaurant in Toronto called Didier.
That's right.
Yeah, he's still around, and I try to make it as well as he did, or does, but it's always tricky. But basically, it's a very simple dish, but really important, like in all simplistic food, is the balance of the seasoning and just the freshness of the ingredients.
Okay.
So what I'm going to kind of do is just walk through the steps of the preparation, which isn't challenging, but certainly, like I said, it's kind of important to follow each step along the way. So the first thing, we use beef tenderloin, AAA grade at minimum. And you can also use like an inside round beef. I wouldn't use anything other than beef just because you can eat it raw and it's safe.
Right. But again, quality of ingredients becomes very important.
For sure. Yeah, you probably want to visit more of an artisanal butcher when purchasing beef for steak tartare and for the burgers as well. Not to say that you can't get good stuff everywhere, but
right.
It's always on the safer side that way. So we've got our piece of beef tenderloin here. So I always dry it first just because it's much easier to work with. And the most important thing is for me as a chef is that all raw dishes are served ice cold and hot dishes are served hot. So that's kind of a good standard rule. So what we want to do is the beef tenderloin will usually come in small pieces. You can always buy the large full tenderloin as well, but this is just a small section. And basically you want to find the grain. So the grain just runs horizontally that way. And then basically we want to take a sharp knife and clean cutting board, everything dry. We don't want any blood or anything on the board because it just makes it difficult to cut. And then what we're going to do is take the knife and just kind of do little fillets by cutting through here. And this way you get an even slice. And then what we'll do is stack that so we can eventually do multiple small cuts. So obviously this is something, if you don't feel comfortable, your butcher would probably be happy to cut this for you. But it's not challenging, just take your time. And again, sharp knives are always the best way to go. So basically when we get to this point, we have our three little fillets. And then we're just going to cut it into cubes. So the most important thing is that you actually cut through the meat. So it should be ideally the little squares of beef. And that way it just marinates better. Like it absorbs all the garnish better.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we'll do is turn it just so it's that way. And you can see that the pieces are nice and straight. And if there's ever any pieces you can't cut through, then you can just toss those.
Awesome.
Because it tends to be sinew or something that's not great to eat.
And is that why you would use a tenderloin in this case, just because it's so tender? And
for sure. Yeah, tenderloin, I mean, to be honest, tenderloin probably doesn't have the most flavor out of all the cuts of beef, but it definitely is the leanest and also has, like you said, the most tender muscle. So it really eats well. Yeah, but again, an inside round would be fine. Eye of round is fine. Sirloin is good too, so.
And would the prep on those cuts be the same?
Yeah, I mean, essentially what you want to do when you're asking your butcher is just ask for something that's like a clean muscle. So if they're giving you, you know, sirloin, that they give you a piece that doesn't have any connective tissues or sinew or anything on it, and no fat, ideally. A little bit of fat's okay, but it's not that great.
See, do you draw? Okay.
For sure. So now what we're going to do is take these straight cut pieces, and then we're just going to cut them into little cubes. So I guess you kind of measure the size. But because tenderloin is so tender, we don't want them too small because they'll lose their texture as you mix them. And then I've got an ice cold bowl ready to mix the beef, which is really important. So what we'll do is just put it right back in that same bowl. And there's many ways which you can approach the seasoning, but I find this order of operation is the best way just because it maintains the texture and you're able to get all of the seasoning that you're looking for. So we always start with a little bit of salt. In this case, I'm using flaky sea salt called Maldon salt.
Yep.
You can find that in most specialty grocers or just kosher salt. One kind of important thing that I think a lot of people at home maybe don't know when cooking is that it's really important to use a salt that's not iodized, because iodized salt has iodine in it and it actually tastes like that.
Yep, right.
So whether you're boiling pasta water or whether you're seasoning a salad, I would always aim for sea salt. So either sea salt or kosher
salt.
Good
tip.
Yeah. And then mayonnaise, you can certainly make your own mayonnaise. Hellman's mayonnaise or any type of high quality mayonnaise is also fine. So if we get the mayonnaise in there, because the mayonnaise is actually gonna act kind of as a lubricant or dressing, so it'll help us not damage the meat. And then we want to put a little bit of Dijon mustard. So you could use grainy Dijon as well, but I just prefer a smooth Dijon.
Okay.
You don't want to go heavy on anything in the beginning, especially when you're first feeling out the tartare, because once you add too much Dijon, then it's going to cost you a lot of tenderloin. So you got to be careful.
That's not cheap.
Yeah, exactly. And then we've got capers, so just normal capers that have been chopped up really finely. And then we have what's called cornichons or gherkins. Mm-hmm. So there's just these baby pickles. So we've cut those into little squares as well. And those will go in. And then we're gonna take some shallots as well, which a shallot, for those of you that haven't seen or don't know the difference, from normal onion, shallots tend to be a little bit sweeter. And when eating raw, I find shallots are much better than a cooking onion.
Right.
Vidalia onions are okay raw, but I find shallots have the best kind of sweetness and natural flavor. And obviously when you're cutting, because I've cut beef on this board, it's not a problem to then cut the onion. I mean, I probably would normally cut the onion ahead of time, but right. It's all going to the same place. Yep. So you don't have to worry about cross-contamination. When cutting shallots, so they come like this. Obviously you want to peel as little as possible just to yield the most out of the onion. And then from there, what I like to do is actually take it apart and take the leaves apart, what we would call leaves, as opposed to just like raw chopping the onion. So I think same with herbs, a lot of people underestimate the importance of really kind of being delicate with the ingredients, because you get the most out of them, and texturally, flavor-wise, they're just so much nicer when the ingredients are handled carefully. So. In this case, we're going to actually cut little julienne, just like we did with the beef. And this way, the onions stay whole. One thing which, you know, I had to learn the hard way when I started working in good kitchens is that chopping herbs, onions, you never chop over something twice. Whereas, you know, okay. You see fast exhibits and stuff, they're like, shh, and it's actually probably the worst thing you could do. And if you ever go to a really high-end kitchen, they'll probably slap you. Well, maybe not, but, you know, they'll think about it. So from here, then we're just going to cut little squares again. So ideally you want the shallots, the pickles, all kind of the same size, smaller than the beef. But I'm only cutting them once, and then I'm not going to do anything to them except mix them. So it's really important that you can see the shallots kind of, there's no liquid coming out of them. They're very like clean cut. Again, a sharp knife is really important for this step. And there.
But this is really a delicate dish.
It is, and I think that's something that, you know, especially now that we all have a little bit more time, I mean, hopefully we do at home, is to kind of take the time and think about the dish, think about the origin, think about why we're making it, because I think everybody lives such busy lives, and a lot of time we get caught up in just kind of getting stuff put together quickly, but it only takes a little bit extra time.
It's true.
To kind of relax and enjoy it, you know what I mean? Like, food should be one of those things that it's an experience. That you enjoy making, enjoy eating, and you know, it kind of builds a sense of community as well.
Yeah.
Then we're gonna add a little bit of Worcestershire, which again is just kind of like a traditional British sauce, I guess, and it has multiple ingredients, but it really brings a nice savory component to the dish. And then a little bit of Tabasco. So we'll say for about 75 grams of cut beef, it's about 3 dashes of each. So that's kind of a good measure. Now it's really important that we're not beating the meat up. So I think what I like to think of this, or what you would call this, is just folding it gently.
Yep.
So basically you're massaging all of these garnishes into the beef. And I put the salt in the beginning just to help with the seasoning. But really there's not much else to it except for the herbs at the end. If you find that it's sticking to the bowl, then you don't have enough mayonnaise. So although it looks like a lot of mayonnaise right now, it actually will come together, and you can see the key is this motion. So you're actually like, just not just, the word folding is important, but it's also, I call it massaging, gently. And so for this tartare, ironically enough, it's a Parisian preparation, but the actual end result, I find, tastes a lot like a Big Mac. So I mean, not to big up the big corporations, but you know, the reality is that the Big Mac is like the perfect seasoned, you know, burger, I would say. I love it. And this tartare, I think, is the closest thing, but I like it better. You know?
That's the first time I've ever heard of a steak tartare being referred to as a Big Mac.
Well, that's how I describe it to cooks. Like, I haven't eaten a Big Mac in years, but I remember it being really good. And when you're explaining to cooks, because it's a hard thing, like, it's intimidating because it's so simple, and it's just beef and a little bit of stuff, and then it comes out, and if it's not done perfectly or
you can
sense it, right? So, and again, keeping it on the cold ice is so important throughout the whole time. And let's say I was having a little dinner party, you could certainly do this now and then keep it on ice and serve in about 10 minutes.
Okay, so that was my question, was is this though really one of those dishes that should be served very close to preparation time?
I think ideally it's definitely better the closer, but it doesn't hurt as long as it stays cold.
Okay.
So what I would do is, if I was mixing and, you know, I still have to prepare my bread, then I would put this, actually, the whole thing in the fridge, just so it stays ice cold. Kind of an interesting tip with parsley. So I only use Italian parsley or flat leaf parsley, just because I like the flavor better. But oftentimes, you know, parsley comes dirty and it comes messy. So once you wash it and spin it, then what I do is actually pull it all together, kind of like a bouquet of flowers.
Yep.
And that's where we would do what we would call a chiffonade. So a lot of people go through the effort of picking apart the individual leaves, which is, you know, if you have that time, that's cool too. But in this case, I'm just going to roll it like a cigar. And then you have all of the leaves like that. And then you just go very finely. Again, one time, you don't want to cut over and over the parsley because it'll actually bruise it and it'll make it taste bitter. So as finely as you can go with the knife, rocking it carefully, obviously keeping your fingers out of the way. But then this can also be used for like veg stock, or you can make pesto, or right, throw it in a smoothie, whatever. And then so we've got the parsley. So now that we know that the beef is fairly well incorporated with everything, then we'll add parsley. I like lots of herbs in my tartare. I find that it just brings a certain level of freshness. And then whether you want to use chives or green onions or scallions is really up to you.
Okay.
Chives can be oftentimes hard to find unless you have them in your garden. The only thing with scallions is that they are a lot stronger than chives. So just from a flavor profile standpoint, I wouldn't put too many. And you want to cut them fine, but same idea. You don't want to bruise them. And you definitely want it to be a nice clean cut. So same thing as the parsley. We'll just go super fine on it. And then we'll fold that in and then we'll give it a taste.
And under normal circumstances, this is a staple on your menu?
Yes, yeah, so steak tartare has been on the menu since day one. I think it's probably one of our best selling dishes. Well, it definitely is. And it's something that I would say we're fairly known for, just because again, a lot of people do their own take on tartare, and I love tasting people's versions of tartare. Like other chefs get creative and I love that. But for me, just the simplicity of this version, it kind of has a comforting place. So then once we get the herbs folded in, it looks good from there.
That's a good sharing dish too.
Really good, yeah. So now what we'll do quickly is just make the crostinis.
Sure.
So we've got some extra virgin olive oil,
yeah,
that my father actually imports. So he named it after me for some reason. I don't know why.
Yeah.
I guess I got lucky. But yeah, my dad, he has a house in Abruzzo. He's from Calabria originally. But he has a house in Abruzzo, which is on the Adriatic coast.
Mm-hmm.
And it's beautiful. It's so many olive groves and vineyards. And olive oil is one of the best things to come out of that region. And then this is just a crusty Calabrese bread. So you can basically use any baguette or anything like that. Very important as well when you're cutting bread is just to kind of be careful and to want to maintain the crumb, the structure of it. You want to crush it because it'll just be that much better and lighter when you're eating it. So we'll take that. I've got the pan on like medium heat.
Okay.
One thing I think is so important too for home cooking is just the idea of temperature control. So
yeah,
oftentimes I think, again, it can be really intimidating, you know, first few times you start cooking and using pans and oil. Most important thing, your pan is dry, you start on low heat, never crank it to the max, because once it hits that point, especially oil like this that's of high grade,
right,
it has a low smoking point,
right,
so it'll burn very quickly. And then once it's burned, it's toast. Literally.
Yeah, I think you're right. For home cooks, I think the challenge is always temperature.
Yeah, well, I think, and I think once you become comfortable, I mean, even for a lot of, you know, restaurant cooks, it is too. So I think it's just one of those things that it doesn't need to be intimidating. And when you have, you know, good appliances and good cookware, it's super easy, you know, and then it just, again, everything, like everything, it takes practice. And I think
right,
cooking is one of those things that's so rewarding once you learn how to even just make a couple different dishes. And I don't know, it's a great way to kind of hang out with family. And
so
I'm sure everybody now is
more and more so.
Yeah, developing that muscle more. Yeah.
Well, and I think it's also the, you know, you were mentioning earlier, because it's not only the process of eating, but I think it's people of learning to really enjoy the process of cooking or baking at home now.
Big time.
And
yeah,
that whole process of doing that, and the kids can get involved in that process.
I think it's probably one of the most positive things that have happened in this circumstance, right?
It's so true.
So once the pan is warm enough, what you'll see is that the oil will start to what we call dance.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll see it start to kind of move around a little bit on its own. And then you don't have to do this. I mean, you certainly eat the tartare on bread that's not toasted. You could also easily toast the bread in the oven with no oil.
Right.
But I mean, when you're using good olive oil, it's very healthy anyway.
And there's a certain flavor to it that, you know, with a good quality olive oil, I think
for sure
adds to.
Yeah, for something as simple as a tartare, the olive oil elevates it big time. So most important thing you want to do now is just make sure that the bread isn't sticking. So you can see it's sizzling a little bit.
Yep.
But I'm not going to, I just want to make sure it's not sticking to the pan, because then it'll actually crisp up better. If it was sticking, then you might get a little bit of burning. So once, it's the same thing as if I was cooking a scallop or anything, even a steak.
Yeah.
Once you get it in the pan, you let it sit for about 10 seconds and then you just shift it around.
And I think that's always, you know, you hear different things, because especially with things like steaks, a lot of people will say, you know, you eat very high heat and don't touch it.
Yeah, I think when you're grilling, it's a little bit different. I find it all depends on the steak itself.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of factors that go into that. But basically, my rule of thumb is once it starts to caramelize, then I'll drop the heat a little bit after moving it once.
Okay.
So I just turn the heat down slightly, just because once you get it to that point of heating, you don't want it to be too hot, but you also don't want it to start steaming.
Right.
And also, I didn't overcrowd the pan, which is really important. Because when you put too many things close together, it'll actually create steam, and that's terrible for basically everything. nothing benefits from that. Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about the olive oil.
Yep.
So how long has your dad been doing that, making the olive oil?
Yeah, my dad started importing the oil about 10 years ago.
Okay.
So we've always had beautiful oil at my house, and my dad worked for the airline, so we traveled a lot. I traveled a lot as a kid, and my life kind of revolved around food always because of that. And once you taste the difference in an olive oil of this quality, so basically it's a first cold press. So they literally take the olives, they make a mash with the olives, with the pits, and then they press that through sieves. So in today's day and age, there's a lot of mechanical processes that kind of simulate that. It's all very temperature controlled, and they can produce excellent oil as well. This one is just produced in a more traditional press.
Okay.
So a lot of presses are like 500 years old, and they're literally just sieves, and they just slowly press the olives down. And
so
then what you get is
a gentle process.
Yeah, so you have first cold press, you have a second cold press, and then the challenge with olive oil a lot of time is that the labeling can be very deceptive.
Okay.
So something can be called extra virgin olive oil if it only has 7% of this in it. You just have to kind of be careful, and typically, you know, a high grade olive oil, it will run about $25 to $40 per liter. Like, that's kind of like the minimum.
So you really do pay for what you get.
You do, but then you use less typically.
Right.
And also actually the health benefits are huge. So this oil in particular, it has the highest level of natural ibuprofen out of any food in the world. So when you taste a high grade olive oil, it actually like catches the back of your throat a little bit. Like you kind of go like it almost hits you.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
ibuprofen, which I found really interesting. So. Yeah, sorry. I'm just gonna get my ring. One sec.
And can people buy this olive oil here?
Yeah, we're starting to sell this particular one
at the restaurant.
Or? We have sold at the restaurant. We have a little pantry at the front. It's something we're looking at doing again, potentially kind of revisiting that a little bit. For the time being, it's tricky to get because importing from Italy is obviously slowing down and everything else, as
yes.
I'm sure you guys know.
Yes. We do.
But for now, I do have a little bit, but just inquire within and we can arrange it for sure. Should I plate this there?
Yeah, sure. Okay, absolutely.
Cool. All yours. So we'll just plate the tartare now quick. So it tastes good, I think.
Yeah.
And really important again is just that it's ice cold, you can feel it. You don't have to use a ring mold. I mean, there's so many ways you could plate it, but I like to use a ring mold. I feel fancy. And this is actually how we prepare the restaurant. We also top it with a soft boiled quail egg at the restaurant, which is really nice. You don't have to. You could also use just a raw egg yolk. Some people really like that. And then the most important thing is, again, not just for presentation, but to kind of keep it. Let's say you're sitting on the patio and you know you're enjoying it slowly. What I would do is actually put this place on ice.
Ice, okay.
But pack it down in the mold, so it stays better as well.
Okay.
Just less oxygen. And basically how it was described to me when I first learned this is that the top of the tartare should look like a sheet of glass. So that's getting, you know, real extreme with it, but it definitely, it adds a lot more to the presentation. And then when you're removing the ring mold, you want to kind of turn it just so if I pulled it straight up, then it would make a bit of a mess.
Okay.
So you turn it like that, and then generally we garnish it with a little bit of parsley or chives again, which is nice. And then we'll put a little bit of the olive oil. I say a little bit, but.
Yeah. You're Italian, that's okay.
Yeah, I actually drink it for breakfast. So. People make fun of me all the time. And then with the pieces of bread, I mean, you don't want them to be, ideally the bread is warm when you're serving it because it's such a nice contrast with the hot and cold.
Right.
It doesn't have to be, but definitely you don't want the bread to sit forever. And then we can either plate it on the same plate, just kind of push it around. And it makes like a nice little bundle there. And that's it. A little bit of malt and salt on top. Usually I season a little bit less in the tartare itself just so I can add a little bit of salt.
Right.
Just for that crunch and that little bit of extra seasoning.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I'm going to move that out here for the camera to have a look at. So, fantastic. I think hopefully everybody will have a chance at least to try it sooner than later.
For sure. And we can post the recipe too, like for some more kind of accurate
right.
ratios.
I'm sure they want to test your version, so I'm,
yeah, yeah.
I'm sure.
And it's fun because, I mean, a lot of people, you know, I know a lot of chefs that have different influences in their restaurant menus, which we do. You know, we have some Korean influence. We have...
You do?
Yeah, okay. But for this one, I personally like the French version, but as I said, you know, you could put like a little bit of pickled, whatever, onion in there and mix it up, or you could put like a little kimchi and do like, you know, Korean version.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
With QP mayo, you can do like a Japanese, like there's so many things you can do. It's really kind of a vessel for creativity, I find, which is nice.
So, you know, we were talking a little bit earlier, but I think the role of food, the role of chefs have really changed, you know, in our world over the last, you know, 10, 15, 20 years. As a chef, kind of what's important to you in today's world?
I think what's really important, obviously, is bringing communities together through sharing food. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that it's so evident in a place like Ontario or in Canada, you know, where we're so fortunate to have all these different cultures influencing us day to day. But sustainability is a really big thing for me, working with local farmers as much as possible and also kind of focusing on sustainable work-life balance for our staff.
Okay.
And for... You know, for our team, because I think restaurants are a really challenging environment, or they can be.
I think people underestimate the amount of hours that you guys actually have to put in to run the restaurant.
It is, yeah. I think what's interesting is just the amount of labor that goes into the preparation of food and of cocktail mixes and of setting up a restaurant, and it kind of gets overlooked at times. And I think a lot of times we don't necessarily appreciate it because we're so used to it. Like we forget to kind of mention to each other, like, great job, and, you know, thank you so much. And
right.
It's
well, because I think it's such an intense environment in all reality, behind the scenes,
it is.
Back of house. It's pretty intense when you guys get slammed with tickets coming in.
And big time, yeah. And I think a lot of environments can be really challenging. And I think, you know, for young chefs, it's really important to maintain positivity, but also to recognize that you're building a skill set that's really important because it's something that you can always use. So cooking is something that I'll never lose,
right.
and I love sharing it with people. And it's definitely, you know, from my perspective, it's kind of the best job I could ever have because it doesn't feel like I'm working.
Right.
And people always say that, like, find something you love and then you don't work a day.
Sure.
And I think it's actually very true in cooking because you're sharing experiences, you're creating memories. And, you know, at the Good Sign in particular, people walk in and the space is really beautiful and, you know, they feel like they're somewhere else. And I think that's kind of, a restaurant should kind of transcend the moment,
right?
And I think it's really cool when you can do that. So,
and I guess for you over the last, you know, I guess for all of us over the last couple months, so many things have changed.
Mm-hmm.
As a restaurateur, as a chef, what would you, you know, how do you think things will change for you coming out of this? You know, and then maybe a difficult question exactly.
Yeah, no, I think it's a good question. I mean, I think we all have to kind of evolve and figure out, you know. I think sustainability is a big part of it. I mean, from a business model standpoint, obviously, but also just from kind of an ethics standpoint and supporting local, as we've always, you know, it's a very strong initiative that's really important. I think sustainability for small businesses in general, not just for restaurants, but
right.
for all small businesses, that we shop locally as much as possible, go to your local restaurants as much as possible. But I think the changes are going to be interesting. I think it's kind of unknown yet how things will evolve. I think
right.
as restrictions start to ease up, you know, maintaining safety standards and making sure guests are safe, staff are safe. That's our main priority as it is. But just learning the ins and outs and figuring out, you know, how to work through it is going to be it's going to be interesting. You know, everybody looks at it as it's a challenge, obviously, but at the same time, it's a kind of a new focus, and I think it's really important that we just adapt. And I think, you know, the burger kit that I'm going to show and other initiatives that we're looking at doing, like take home food,
right,
I think is a really great way, again, just to kind of deliver that restaurant quality experience, but, you know, having people be a part of it too.
Yeah. Well, and I think it's interesting because, you know, with the restaurants and chefs we've had on here, I think that was one discussion around, you know, the whole takeout for a lot of restaurants was something really new that they really had to very quickly adapt and figure out. And I think, you know, for the chefs that we talked to, and I think similar to you, is it's not necessarily just doing what they were doing, because some things don't travel well.
For
at
sure.
The end of the day, you know, you still want that customer to have that great quality experience when they get home, and not every dish can do that.
Yeah, I think it's an important balance in figuring out, you know, obviously what travels, like you said, and also what's actually kind of appealing in a home sense or
right.
in a home setting versus in a restaurant setting.
Yeah.
Like oysters, obviously, are something that's challenging. You know, if we just send oysters to someone's home, shucking them can be tough. It can also be great.
Yeah.
But it's something we have to, you know, reconsider
consider.
If you want to put that on the takeout menu.
Yeah.
Things like a burger travel or pizza travels really well. But yeah, we're working through that, and I think it's something that all restaurants are adapting to for the long term, because
right.
I think it's important to have kind of a dual
business model
where
absolutely.
You can do both. Because we are fortunate that we can do that. A lot of restaurants, they depend so heavily on the dining room as being like the main place to serve, that it's challenging, you know, and that I think is probably the biggest hurdle that we're gonna all be facing in the short term. But
right.
again, I think communities are so supportive in Toronto and surrounding areas for small businesses, and you can already feel it. Like, you can feel people
right.
getting excited, and
really,
you know, they
yeah.
can't wait to get back. And again, I think it's all a measure of the times. You know, restaurants are a challenging business as it is.
Mm.
And I think the economy, you know, with all the hurdles that we've been facing in general, I think we just have to figure out how to do our best.
Yeah, yeah. It's gonna be an evolution.
Yeah, exactly.
So the burger kit, let's talk about that, because I think that's a great evolution and kind of, you know, you were talking about, again, a bit about earlier, still coming up with ideas that will give a great experience at home.
For sure.
I think
so,
the burger kit is a great one.
Yeah, and I think like a burger is something that's so simple in theory, but again, it's kind of really easy to do well, and then also really easy to
yes.
do not so well.
Agreed.
The boxes.
We are,
just the burger. Sleepy. Thank you.
So this is what they would get from you if they came and
yeah,
picked up a burger kit.
So we do kits for four.
Okay.
So it comes with four patties. They're about a quarter pound and a bit each.
Okay.
It's a house ground mix. So it's specifically ground for us. And it's basically a combination of ground chuck and brisket, and then a little bit of ground beef fat as well. And then we just have cheddar cheese. And basically, it's kind of similar to the tartare in that, you know, the preparation is everything. So there's a couple things that really stand out for me when making a burger. The first is that the meat isn't too cold. I'll just season it right on here. So the burgers come backpack, which is great.
Yep.
And
do they get those deli containers as well, like
yep.
When they order from you? So
yeah, for sure.
That's there?
Yep, okay. So they get all the garnishes. So
okay.
Basically, we're just recreating our restaurant burger at home, which
okay.
is nice. And for us, it's been, you know, the burger is always something that I think stands out, just because the bun is really good and everything is kind of, it's especially good compared to a lot of burgers, I would say. So first thing we're gonna do is just take some salt. And basically what this is gonna do is essentially season the meat, but also it's gonna start to dehydrate a little bit. So there's always a little bit of excess moisture in the patties.
Okay.
So we'll let that sit for just a couple minutes.
Okay.
And
so again, you're just using the salt to also help just take out some of the moisture.
For sure, yeah. The enemy to all searing or cooking is moisture.
Right.
So if I was cooking a ribeye steak, I would do the exact same thing.
Right.
With a ribeye, I would definitely temper it a little longer, meaning I would leave it out for probably 20 minutes. With these, they're okay to cook fairly cold, but you just don't want them to be too cold.
Yeah, I don't think people would have thought about that with the burger, because typically, you know, with the steak, people know or think about bringing it to room temperature or bringing it.
Right.
But with the burger, I don't think people would have thought.
Yeah,
about
it
that.
Will so benefit like the closer to room temp it gets.
Okay.
What we'll do first, actually, I'm just going to sear these.
Absolutely.
Sorry.
No worries.
So yeah, I think burgers are again, it's something that you can have so many versions of, and people often you know, will create their kind of a special recipe. And for us, it's literally just meat. And that's something in terms of the patty itself. I believe that putting the garnish on top is better than putting the garnish inside. Which it just kind of, it depends on the quality of meat. But again, the most important thing, if you're going to an artisanal butcher, or even if you go to a grocery store that has a good butcher program, you just ask for single ground beef. So you don't want the beef to be ground multiple times. It just gives the burger a much better texture this way. And then whenever we're doing any cooking with meat, or even in this case with the bun, you could use clarified butter, but I really like grapeseed oil. So grapeseed oil is a
high smoking point.
It's very healthy. It's readily available. So what I'm going to do is actually toast the buns very lightly with the grapeseed. So same idea. I've got it on low to medium high heat. And basically, before I put the burgers in, I want to know that my pan is at the level I want it.
Right.
So I wouldn't like rush to throw the buns in now, because it hasn't quite reached that level yet.
Okay.
So once the pan is fully coated, and this is more just a preference. You don't have to toast the buns.
Right.
I just really like it.
And what's the importance of, and maybe it's personal taste, but fat content in a burger?
Yeah, so I think a lot of people, you know, being health conscious, more health conscious, look for things that are more lean in general. What happens with burgers when they're too lean is they just don't taste like much, and they won't actually stay together a lot of time. So let's say, you know, if you had like a 10% fat content,
right,
it's probably not high enough. We aim for about 25%, which is basically like a medium ground beef.
Okay.
But again, because it's single ground, I find texturally, like the fat renders out, but it delivers flavor. So it doesn't end up being like this fatty
burger,
you know.
Right.
So I think just from a beef standpoint, you know, it's really important to have some flavor through fat. So once the bun is lightly toasted, just like that.
Oh, it's quick.
Yeah. It really doesn't take long. And it also depends on the bun itself.
Right.
But basically, we'll just put those there. So this is something you could certainly do well in advance. If you were, you know, preparing, let's say we had 16 burgers or 10 burgers.
Right.
You get all your buns ready, have your burgers tempering, and kind of figure things out in stages. Definitely have all your garnishes ready to go, which I already have, which is nice.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good
shout
thing
out
about
to
the
burger kit.
Yeah, burger kit.
Yeah. So then what we'll do, I'm just going to wipe the pan out quick.
Yep. And is this a brioche type bun?
It is, yeah. It's a milk bread, essentially.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it doesn't have too much egg in it. But I like it. It's a little bit softer. To be honest, if I wasn't having this bun, I would probably use like a Wonder Bread, you know, like a Wonder Bun.
Yeah, there is like a comfort factor to
there
to
is,
the,
yeah.
To the Wonder
they're
Bread.
They're a little small. And these ones, I mean, I would call our burger like a gourmet burger.
Right.
But at the same time, it's, again, taking the very simple kind of pleasures of like a Big Mac or a Whopper and trying to make it homemade.
Right.
Well, not trying to, make it homemade. Yeah. So now what we'll do is sear the burgers. And again, it's a low fuss, low mess. You can definitely do these on the grill, which is phenomenal as well. The only difference when doing it on the grill is that you'd want to shape the burgers a little bit flatter first.
Sure.
And you want to get your grill really hot, and then take a rag with some grapeseed or veg oil and just brush the grates.
Okay.
Don't put oil on the burger, because it'll cause it to burn. So people often, when grilling too, same concept as a steak, they think high heat, high flame, everything, you know, is a great flavor. But the problem with that, especially if you're using a gas grill, is you don't really want too much flame. You want more what would be similar to an ember.
Okay.
So it's kind of like low flame, but still hot.
Okay. So. And what temperature are you now trying to get the pan or?
If I had to estimate, it's probably like 450 degrees.
Okay.
So that's probably like the
minimum. So actually quite high.
Yeah, so you can see the oil is actually going to start smoking. And I have these spatulas, which are awesome for pressing the burgers. So I'm just going to do two for now. But you can see once, so in this case, I actually want the oil to start smoking.
Right.
And that's why I would never use olive oil or anything with a low smoking point. And that's where grapeseed, canola is okay, like if it was like a really good quality one.
Right.
But really you want it just smoking so you can see little smoke coming off. And then basically what we're gonna do is, I'm not gonna manipulate these much. I will give it like a light press.
Okay.
But the key to a good burger I find is less movement and less manipulation. You don't wanna make the meat tough by like working it too much. So then we're gonna put it in the pan. So in this case, I'm actually not going to move them just because I want it. I'm going to slowly caramelize. So it'd be different if I wasn't cooking the burger all the way through necessarily on here, but I am going to be. And so basically you want it to kind of start to adhere. You start to caramelize. It's called like a Maillard reaction. So it's just like the protein caramelization. And then what I'm going to do is take these two spatulas and you'll see this at classic burger places. They'll press it. And this is why you would call this a smash burger.
Yep.
And if it lifts, it's not a big deal. Like it's no problem if it moves a little bit.
Right.
If it was sticking, then your pan might not be hot enough.
Okay.
But I'm gonna keep pressing this until it kind of reaches the thickness that I'm looking for. And you don't want it to be too thin and you don't want it to be too thick. We serve the burgers at a medium internal temperature, so that's totally up to the individual. If you'd rather eat it well done, that's totally cool too, but I will show how to make it well done and stay juicy.
Okay.
So generally speaking, we want to cook it to about 125 if you're using a probe, and then the residual heat will bring it to about 145.
And that'll just
as it rests, which is like a medium. But if you want to cook it to 165 or 180, which would be more well done, I would cook it to like 145 and then let it sit. And then you finish it after.
Okay.
Because what you want to do, and that's why we have this wire rack, which is vital when cooking any protein, even fish. I rest fish, even people think it's weird, but it allows all the juices inside to permeate and to distribute evenly. So what happens if, let's say, after cooking these burgers, or let's pretend it's a steak, if I just put it right on a plate, all the moisture is going to leach out because it goes to the hottest point. But when it's raised up on a rack, it can actually, it allows the heat to circulate around and cools evenly. So definitely not something you want to run away from when the burgers are on. Be ready for a little bit of splatter. I know you can get splatter guards and stuff, but it makes me feel like I'm in the kitchen. So I like the...
And with the burger kit, Vittorio, how much in advance do people need to order it? Or is it pretty readily available for the...
All the time. Yeah, we're always ready. It's definitely something that, you know, we really want people to try at home because I think it's, a burger is one of those things that I think we kind of pass it off as being, oh, it's just a burger, you know what I mean? But then there's a lot of people who are super passionate about burgers, like myself, and I try to make my burger as well as I make, you know, my margarita pizza. Like, I think of it as the same way where if you follow the steps, it's going to be that much better. And not that I know everything about burger, but, I think if you follow kind of like a set rule. You know, you want the patty to be caramelized, you want it to be rested, you want the cheese to be melted, you want a good bun, good garnishes. I think it makes all the difference.
Well, I think the great thing, too, though, is that with your kit, you've actually done a lot of work for people.
Yes.
You know, because actually you spend a lot of time, people spend a lot of time prepping the garnishes.
For sure. Yeah, it's a lot, right? If you have to get a head of lettuce, you have to get a tomato, you got to get onions. Like, we use pickled onions in our burger. We make both sauces. So one's a Russian dressing, which is very similar to, I guess, a Big Mac sauce.
Big Mac. You like the Big Mac.
Yeah, I'm back on it.
Okay.
Yeah. As a kid, I did. I can't eat them anymore. And then Dijonnaise, which is, it's basically like a grainy Dijon mustard mayo.
Okay.
So we do both just because I find it adds different complexity. And then I actually turned down the heat a little bit. Because,
I was going to ask you about the temperature setting.
Yeah, so now that, because it's caramelizing and I'm getting a nice crust on the one side, I'm able to turn it down a little bit. If I turn it down too early, it would start steaming. The one thing you never want to see is steam, because that just means moisture is coming and it's not going to caramelize and get nice flavor.
Right.
People often have the perception that you know, caramelizing or searing is sealing juices. It's not about that. It's more about caramelizing to create flavor. Okay. And you just build a different level of umami, especially when you put enough salt.
So, right.
So we're gonna just kind of check the underside. So you can see it lifts very easily. And the underside looks pretty much perfect. So at this point, depending on how quickly I want to eat it, or how quickly we're going to eat it, I could just basically cook it the whole way right now, which I will do for one of them with the well done. But for the other one, if you're having a big party and, or you have a big family, then you can basically cook them to this point, and then you can just rest them and then reheat them when you're ready to eat.
Okay.
So for the one, I'm going to do that. And then for the other, I'll do it well done.
Okay.
So this is the one that I'm gonna eventually serve medium.
Okay.
And then this one I'll serve well done. So I'm just gonna cook it a little bit further than that. But you can already see all these juices that are kind of dripping out. It's basically a combination of just fat and just the internal juice. But basically, if I didn't do that, all that juice would just rush out. And then you get like a super dry, gritty burger.
And right now, is the kit available in both locations?
Yes, the burger kit is available in both locations. They're $49 for four burgers.
Okay.
So it's a pretty
which is great.
Yeah, pretty sweet deal.
Yeah.
And you know, it's basically the highest quality meat, bun, everything we can find.
Yeah, and I think that's you know, the meat quality is so important.
Yeah, it makes a huge difference. I mean, I think a lot of us get intimidated too when you're going to the grocery store and then, is this beef any good? I don't know what this is. And again, not everybody has time or access to butcher shops. So I think this is a pretty cool idea just to give people that option. So I'm going to take that one out, turn the pan off.
And with the meat actually, so you actually only seasoned it because, you know, a lot of people will season the meat in the grind.
Yeah.
But in your case, you actually season the meat right on.
I find what happens when you put too much seasoning within the meat is just it becomes muffled, like the flavor isn't very clean. Where in this case it's literally just beef, and if you look at, again, not to promote fast food, but those concepts, like, they're always just beef. No fast food concept or place is putting onions in their burgers.
Right.
In the meat. You know what
right.
I mean? So they figured it out a long time ago, I think. So for the when we're reheating the burger, so this one, I mean, you can kind of feel it. This is still definitely a little bit under.
Yeah.
Whereas this one's pretty much fully cooked.
Okay.
And then we're just going to dress them up.
Okay.
So we'll dress up the buns, and then I'll just show you how to steam the cheese after.
So, Chef, many people will recognize you from Top Chef.
Yeah, still?
Absolutely. I think it's... maybe I can ask you a couple of questions about your experience there.
Yeah, for sure.
I guess, what stage were you in your career when you went on to Top Chef?
So I was kind of toiling with the idea of getting into the grocery business on the food production side. I wasn't sure about restaurants just because it was such hard work, and I had seen a lot of really great chefs, worked with a lot of really great chefs that, you know, didn't necessarily have time for their families and whatever. So before I went on Top Chef, I was pretty much heading that direction. And then I thought, you know what, let me try this one last time, because I had been cooking in food production settings where, you know, it wasn't the same level as what I was used to in terms of intensity, in terms of the quality. And so when I went on Top Chef, it was an incredible experience because it kind of brought me back to my best, I guess, and it pushed me to be a better cook. And it was a really incredible experience. And then right after that, I said, you know, I have to open a restaurant now because I felt so confident and so excited again, because food is one of those things that when you work with it every single day, it can tend to impact how you look at it. Right. So I had become, uncertain about restaurants, and then being on Top Chef, cooking for great chefs and seeing, all the great chefs that I was cooking with.
Right.
I was like, I think I want to do this still. So I went back into the restaurants, and then, I found some great partners and we opened the Good Son at that point. Basically, right when I was on, when the show was being aired, that's when we opened. Yeah, so it was actually really good timing, too.
So what was your, I guess, most memorable challenge, or, you know, good or bad, that you remember from Top Chef?
I think there were many. I think probably cooking for David Chang or for Chef Morimoto, those were the two highlights for me because they're both like two of my favorite chefs, and I, you know, I have all their books and always kind of study. And it was always a complete surprise as to who was going to be the judge.
So you guys actually didn't really know.
We didn't know anything. So it was okay. We were completely isolated from friends, family, from the world. And then you know, the challenges were basically presented and then start cooking. So it wasn't, you know, I think a lot of TV or the people think in TV that it's all kind of played out, but for us it wasn't. Like, we had no idea, you know, there was no kind of preset.
Right. So it really was real in the sense.
Yeah, totally real time. Okay. Yeah, which was cool.
Your toughest challenge?
I don't know. That's a tough question. I think probably, honestly, just staying motivated and keeping my eye on the prize at the time, because it was hard. I mean, being separated, I was there for like 35 days total,
wow.
Or 34 days, I think. And just staying motivated and staying positive, because if you did poorly in a challenge,
right,
the judges made you feel that. So it was hilarious. I mean, after the fact, but you would definitely feel low, like,
right,
if you'd struggled. So luckily I didn't struggle too much, but
I think the challenge too is that when we watch you guys too, it's, you know, your every dish counts
big,
like,
time.
There's,
yeah,
no saving grace. If you had a bad dish, then
no,
you know, whatever you did before is gone.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's the interesting thing, is that every challenge is a clean slate.
Right.
So it doesn't matter if, let's say, you know, I did a great job in the last 10 challenges, if I screw up this one, I could go home.
Right.
And that's something that when I was there, it messed with your head a lot, because you know, you build up some confidence, then all of a sudden you screw something up and the clock stops and you're like, ah, you felt like you had enough time. I remember there was like a pasta challenge and I just made my dough, but I didn't allow enough time for the water to boil. So I was sitting waiting for the water to boil, like looking at it, begging it to boil. I wish it was a Miele stove, but it wasn't. And then I didn't get it done. And I remember like just getting to the plate, having the pasta in a bowl and, you know, starting to plate it. And then it was like, time up. And I was like, ah. I threw the pasta. It was terrible. Yeah. So we can dress the burger buns now. So again, very simple in terms of the garnishes. But
a lot of the cheese is already melted, actually.
Yeah, well, that's why I put it on while it's resting.
Right.
And then I'll steam it lightly in the pan.
Okay.
So this is the Russian dressing. So as much as or as little as you'd like. I like quite a bit of sauce on the burger. I don't like it to be dry at all, even though the meat is quite moist. You definitely want to add enough of the sauces. So that's the Russian dressing on the bottom. I put the Dijonnaise on the top.
And this is one of your burgers from the restaurant?
Yep. Yeah, this is the exact burger. Like, we don't hide anything behind the scenes.
No secrets.
No. Well.
Well, yeah, I mean, there are, but.
Yeah. And then we've got beautiful lettuce, pickled onion, and pickles. So it's a lot of ingredients for one, you know, simple burger.
Right.
But at the same time, you kind of have to go through the motion if you want to say it's a good son burger. So the lettuce, some people like whole leaf lettuce. I really like shredded lettuce, just because I find that when you're eating, it doesn't get cut up and doesn't feel like a salad. So that's up to you.
I thought you were going to say it made you feel like you're eating a Big Mac again, but you know.
I can't keep plugging
McDonald's.
Yeah,
I know, seriously.
My corporate deal ran out with it. So then we'll just put, what I do just to keep everything intact is I'll put the pickles, so about 3-4 just dill pickles, like that, spread out evenly. Again, every burger bite should be virtually the same, I feel. And that goes there.
So how much of your Italian heritage would you say gets into your food?
I think now I'm probably cooking a little bit more Italian than I ever had.
Okay.
I did train in Italy for a little while. And I'm obviously a huge lover of Italian food, but I really love all foods. And so it's kind of I think the simplicity of Italian food is always carried with me through my training. But when it comes down to actual ingredients I want to use and stuff, I really like everything. So I find, I mean, obviously Italians don't really make the greatest burgers. No, I mean, they might. But generally speaking, I mean, the burger is an American thing, and I think, or Canadian. So this one, so we put it like that. So what I'm going to do is just turn the pan back on.
Okay.
I just need a little bowl. A metal bowl? Just any metal bowl as well. This will work.
Oh, to steam the...
Yeah, so this might be slightly unconventional. I'm just going to actually wipe this guy out first. So I find we use like a medium cheddar cheese for our burger. You can also use like if you weren't using our kit, right. Shame on you, but that's not your fault.
Well, there are some viewers that are actually from Vancouver and Montreal
that are watching us.
So you can't blame them unless you want to do like overnight delivery to them.
We'll try maybe eventually. So no need to really clean the pan. I'm just trying to remove the excess oil.
Okay.
So this was the well done, and then this was the regular.
Yeah.
So I'll just do one at a time.
Sure.
So I've got the pan, again, on medium-ish heat.
Okay.
And then I've got a small bowl. You could do this in a lot of different ways, but this is probably the easiest way. And we'll put the burger in, pour the water, and then let the bowl sit there to melt the cheese.
Okay.
And then that should be.
And you're just going to pour the water on the pan to create the steam?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. So here's a question for you, Chef. Your toughest judge on Top Chef?
Most intimidating was...
Not to put you on the spot, but...
No, that's okay. I mean, Mark McEwen, obviously, is he's the head judge and
right.
A very celebrated, legendary chef in Canada. So he always would give the hard looks. It was funny because when you go up to be judged, then those lights would get really bright all of a sudden. And so you were sweating, So it's like the brightest lights. I didn't know lights could get that hot. Chef McEwen was always a tough one to face. But when we did it, it was nonstop celebrities, and I was blown away because I didn't know, right? Like you watch previous seasons and you see a lot, but we had Wiley Dufresne from WD-50.
Wow. Yep.
Who else? It was just nonstop. Like to be honest, it became like, oh, who's gonna be today? you just didn't know what to expect. But yeah, I think Mark was definitely probably the hardest because you knew that you had to do a good job in front of him.
Right. Well, and he was there every week.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he'd remind you. Yeah. So we've got the burger in the warm pan, and then we'll just pour a little bit of the water.
Oh, okay.
And then I'll cover it. So obviously something you need to be careful while you're doing, make sure you focus. And this was the medium burger. So now you can see the cheese is melted nicely.
Right.
And I'll scoop it out. No water there. And then right on the bun. And then I'll do the same with the well done. It's okay if the water stays in there. And that's kind of nice. If you have some people in your family like a well done, some people don't mind it less cooked.
Right.
I prefer it on the medium side.
Yeah.
Is that you can have that option just by cooking that little bit of extra. And because we rested this, the center won't be dry, but it is fully cooked.
Okay.
So the resting is everything actually. And
it's actually quite a bit of water you put in there.
Yeah, I don't know if I may put a little too much.
Too much? Okay,
all right. I don't know if you catch that one.
No, it's okay.
And then I'm going to put a little bit of salt on the tomato just because I like that. And then a little bit of pepper on the burger itself, which is totally optional. Because you don't really want the burger to be swimming, but you do want to make sure that the cheese melts. And that goes there.
And at the restaurant, how often do you guys change menu? Like how important is seasonality and to you, and how does that evolve or help you evolve the menu?
Yeah, I think when we first started, we were really changing menu all the time.
Okay. Which I know is a challenge
heavily.
For...
Yeah, it's challenging. Also, I think then a lot of people, they get disappointed, a lot of guests, because they would come and they're like, oh, but I had this dish last time. Why don't you have it?
Right.
So we try to kind of figure out a balance where we more switch suppliers, so for things like tomatoes or lettuce or our Brussels sprouts, as soon as Ontario versions are available, we switch right to those.
Okay.
So we do use some imported product throughout the year, but whenever the opportunity is there, we buy locally.
Right.
And then we also come up with seasonal dishes that are like kind of like chef special menu dishes.
Okay.
So I work on those with our team, and we figure out kind of what's best and try to keep it exciting because we don't want the menu to become stagnant. At the same time, we want to keep the dishes people love.
Right, absolutely.
So it's a balance. But I mean, as a chef, I've always focused and really excited about springtime in Ontario. And our growing season is so short, but it's also incredible what farmers grow here. So it's always been kind of a huge inspiration. I mean, the winter is always tough. Really, how many ways do you turn squash into something good? But at the same time, that's also an interesting challenge. And I think that's what kind of motivates me. So it's nice.
That looks fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah, thanks for sharing that with us. I'm going to also slide that out there. For the so again, the burger kit, great option, $49.
Yep, $49 for four burgers.
Four burgers, which is a great deal. And
for sure.
A lot less work.
You've
done the work for...
Yeah, I put a little theater on it, but I mean, you can do it pretty quick.
You know,
it's pretty, it's probably a 20-minute start to finish to really do it well. And it's super juicy and satisfying. And I think even when you look at the burger too, just as kind of like a technical note, is that you don't see juices going everywhere.
Right.
Once you bite into it, it'll be juicy.
Right.
But it also makes it a lot less messy. The bun doesn't get soggy and yeah.
Great. Well, thank you for joining us.
No, it's thanks for having me.
So again, Good Son, two locations, Queen Street.
Yep.
As well as Shops of Don Mills.
Yep.
Both open Tuesday to...
Wednesday through Sunday.
Wednesday through Sunday.
Yeah.
Curbside pickup.
Yep, curbside pickup and Uber Eats, Skip the Dishes, and DoorDash.
And visit the website for all the details around what people can order.
Yep, thegoodsontoronto.com.
Perfect. And you know, I hope really soon, you know, all our viewers as well as us will be able to get out there and you know, experience the atmosphere, because I think, like you said, I think it's important in the dining experience.
We're excited. Well. I mean, I think sometimes we tend to be so caught up in day-to-day life that we forget to appreciate the little things.
Right.
And for us, I mean, you know, to not be able to serve our guests in our space has been a huge kind of awakening moment. And say, wow, I mean, that was a privilege, you know, whereas you get caught up in it and you feel like, oh, whatever, it's just, you know, day-to-day life. But I don't know. I think everybody, at least I know like my circle and my friends and partners, were so excited to kind of bring that back. Because we all miss it, right?
And I think we're close.
Yeah, I think
I think we're close. So again, want to thank you for that.
Thank you.
As well, I want to thank you for you know, with the meals that we're going to purchase from you guys.
Yep.
Collectively, we will donate that to the frontline workers here in Ontario.
Which is amazing.
So that'll be that's great.
And thank you to you guys for that, because I think one thing that we've all been very fortunate with is the effort and the courage of.
Yeah.
Of those workers. So
yeah,
I think,
that have really served communities, you know, across the country and have had to be out there.
Big time.
In the front. So, and, you know, hopefully we'll give them some amazing meals to take a little break from. So
awesome.
Yeah. So thanks so much for joining us once again.
Thank you, Killa.
I want to thank everybody out there as well for joining Chef Vittorio and us here on hashtag Miele Dines Local. Be sure to join us next week. We have Surreal Sweets, who's going to join us on Thursday. As well, next Wednesday, June 24th, as many of you know, for those of you that have had the experience to come to one of our meal experience centers across the country to attend one of our classes, unfortunately right now we are also unable to offer these classes in person, but we actually will be offering these classes virtually. So next Wednesday, we have a class at 3 p.m. Where you can learn more about the Miele Speed Oven, and that's our combination convection oven as well as microwave oven, and you can use them together. So be sure to register online to attend that class with us. So on behalf of Good Son, our team here at Miele, we want to thank everybody for joining us. We also want to send a very big thank you out to the frontline workers again that are out there continuing to provide services across the communities. We wish everybody a fantastic weekend. Be safe, and we look forward to seeing you at the restaurants as well as here online with Miele Live. Again, have an amazing weekend and the rest of the day as well.